Let it be holy.
Killed, people have been hurt, it's pandemonium. And I was, it was in the background. I looked at the official story. It was in the background. And then I looked at her. Some woman came on. Her son was in the club. And she was crying. And I don't know what happened to my son. I don't know if he's living or he's dead or so on and so forth. There is a reason why this church endeavors not to have functions, social functions, on Saturday, so that people can rest up for Sunday. Now, what were these people doing in the club till 2 o'clock in the morning? They were looking for something. They were looking to have a good time, because that's their perspective of having a good time. You may or may not know this, but in the scripture, one of the sins that's mentioned in the New Testament is the sin of partying, party time, party mentality. So people that are out that late on a Saturday night, they're looking, and why would they not more be there? Because some of them thought they already found their happiness. So they find someone, they go home, they, hook up, and they're happy for a very short period of time. But it doesn't last. I already have a habit when I buy something, especially a small appliance, that I keep the box. I have a closet full of boxes at home. Anybody living in my house, I'm going to be careful in that closet because those boxes will fall out. Why do I keep the box? Because I give it a period of time, and if it doesn't work right for a minimum period of time, guess what? I kept the receipt. I take it back. I'm known as Father John Return at home. I take it back. Because when I buy something, I expect it to work for a reasonable amount of time. If it doesn't, I take it back. I want longevity. I want things to last. I don't go for the short term. I don't go for the quickie. I go for the longing. So with me, when I think about being happy, and I think about a relationship with the Lord, I'm not looking for some short thing. I'm looking for something long, something that is lifelong. It amazes me, and I thank God. Well, it isn't amazing, it amazes other people. Father Juan is with us today, and he knows that it's all just worth it to be six human men. We take 3 sips, right? Not me. I take 3 gulps. I drink half the chalice. Am I a wine? No, no, I'm not a wine. I want as much of that. I mean, because I love you, I need some for you. But I like to receive Holy Communion. And that is why, usually, I get to consume what's left. But not today. Because today, my brother, Father Juan, finishes for me. Now, it's kind of meandering in the altar while the most of you would have said, but nothing to do. Because the chalice, and then when I finally saw what it was doing, it was just a little bit of blood. I said, okay, finish it already. I'm not trying to make it feel bad, because it's really, it's his job. The second priest would consume the chalice. He didn't hear me say, don't consume the chalice. But what I'm telling you is why. Because I am coming to church, I am receiving communion, I am worshiping the liturgy, because I need it. It's the only thing that gives me life. Because of it, everything else in my life is life. So without Jesus, not only is there no life, what you're living is dead. And those people, God bless them, that were shot, or some of them were killed at that nightclub, they're already dead, maybe. Where is the spirit? Why would Christians, why would good Christians, why would people that encounter Jesus in the liturgy? And I spoke about my daughter Anastasia, this was Alexandra. I said, I love the liturgy because I encounter Jesus in the liturgy. I don't encounter Jesus in just the icon or in the reading of the word. I encounter Jesus in the living liturgy. That is where my life is, and that is where your life should be. And if it is not, you need to ask yourself why. Why? I'm not against people going out, want to go to nightclub, want to have a drink, want to go to the movies. So I watched a movie yesterday. I went to the movies. I like those movies. I watched a movie yesterday called Me Before You. Maybe you've seen this movie. I watched the movie, the story about a paraplegic man in England that was very, very, very active before. before his accident. And I'm going to kill the new movie for you because I want to make a point. And I watched the movie, and at the end of the movie, he had decided that he was going to have to commit suicide. He was going to go, I think it was a suicide in one of the countries there where this was legal. And they tried to talk him out, and he said, no, I don't want to live my life like this. I don't want to be in pain. If I can't have the life I had before, I don't want to live. When I left the movie, I thought to myself, this is the type of a film, this is like propaganda. And don't think that movies are not propaganda, because they are. This is the propaganda to tell people, if your life is not the quality of life that society says it should be, you should end it. It's not worth living. It's wrong. Because God gives life and God takes life. So I thought to myself about this young man, I said, sir, if you had known Jesus Christ, if you had known that when you die, you cannot receive communion, you know that? Because you have a soul, it's not physical. You cannot receive the physical, spiritual body and blood of Jesus Christ when you are dead. If nothing to keep you going, that would be enough reason. I told my family, if God were to get like that, don't you turn any machines off. If I can come back and haunt you, I will come back and haunt you. But you cut my life short. I want every opportunity there is to live so that I can get to the next communion. But when I left the movie, I was so overwhelmed. I called up my son, Johnny. I said, are you home? He said, yes. I said, I need you to come home. So I went to him. He was outside doing some gardening. And I hugged him so strong. He said, did somebody die? I said, no, somebody lived. I'm just so thankful you're alive. I'm so thankful that you're here. I'm so thankful to God. Now we spend our lives, and if you notice, lots of quote-unquote missionaries, they like to try and save the world. I don't think I have an experience, but I have. You'll like this. I'll meet people and they'll tell me, I'm going on a mission trip. I said, really? Where are you going? So we're going to go to South America. Okay, what are you doing in South America? We're going to teach them about Jesus. I look at them incredulously. You know why? We're going to teach them about Jesus. I said, they're all Catholics. They know about Jesus. No, no, we're going to teach them about the real Jesus. I said, what Jesus do you think that they got? Something fake? You know, Orthodox churches not send missionaries. We don't send missionaries to countries where they believe in God. We don't. Did you ever see a missionary from Syria? Shevet Wahid Ibn Suri, a missionary? La abadan. We don't go and send missionaries even to the Muslims. You know why? The church says at least they believe in God. Not right, but at least they believe in God. Go to the places where they don't know there's a God. Go to the places where they worship water and fire. Teach them about God. That's the difficult missionary work when they don't know. When you go and you take you make a Catholic into a Protestant. What is God? Musical chairs. We don't do this. If someone comes to us because they want to have a fuller understanding and relationship with Christ, that they find they want to, that's fine. But we are trying to always save the world. Donald Trump says we're going to make America great again. I don't know what it's like being great. And in fact, I don't know if it ever was great. So I don't know what he's talking about. But everybody running a popular world is going to make it good again. They talk about the good old days. When I was about 8, I was looking out the window of my parents' home in Brooklyn, and an old Model T Ford went down the street. This is probably back in the 50s. And my mother said, ah, that's like the good old days. I thought the good old days was the Model T Ford. And people talk about the good old days. No, no. It's not that they were good. It's not that they were old. They were just times when you were happy. So instead of us trying to bring back something that is gone, I got this report, isn't it? This is Mrs. Reporter, she's a school teacher, right? She teaches reading. I got angry with me one day. I said to her, let me tell you something. You didn't like what I said, but I swear I told her. I said, you see this? This is the future of reading. Remember that? I said, this is the future of reading. She got angry. No. I love books. I said, you love books. You like to turn pages in books. That's wonderful. But the fact is that reading today is on this. I am cursed because I took the New York Times for 4 years. I stopped it 10 years ago. I still get emails. Would you like to come back? Hello. What are you going to get into your head? I don't get the news from the newspaper. I don't have time. You know, I walk every morning. I guarantee you all the houses that I go by, and as a man delivering the land of Setna, I will, if I was a betting man, betting money, that the people getting that newspaper are a minimum of 60 years old. That's the generation that reads newspapers. I don't read newspapers. So the fact is, I'm not trying to go backwards. America is only great when it comes to Jesus Christ. Other than that, it's just rich. It doesn't make it great. Only Jesus and that which is related to him makes us happy. Now, if you don't understand that, if you don't feel that, then you're going to wind up going to the clubs. Hopefully you don't get shot. We live in very, very difficult times. Do you realize that in the last 72 hours, Orlando was on the national scene, one for the murder of a young singer. And you know, if you don't know, the theater she was shot in used to be owned and renovated by one of our own families, about Spiros. And last night, this happened at Orange, down on Orange Avenue. Children, if you want to be happy for the rest of your life, you need to come to Jesus Christ. Because without Christ, you're existing, but you're not living. And if you're not living, before we finish, we have a special event today, which we will be asking you to do. We will have four. This is the final day of the regular classes of our Sunday school. And as is our tradition, we like to give out to our Sunday school children their recognition for their work. I just want to tell you that this was a very good year for our Sunday school. I want to thank our teachers, but I especially want to thank the parents of the students, because we had more regular, every Sunday, children coming to Sunday school this year than we ever had before. To the children, thank God that your parents wanted to learn more about Christ and the church. Because in reality, without the children, the church is not in the future. It'll always be the church, but without the children, there won't be anybody here. So I want to thank the children, their parents, the home, the teachers that take this very seriously. And they take it so seriously that the children, again this year, have voted to continue Sunday school through the summer. Imagine, can you imagine that happening in public school? They said, no, we don't really want vacation. We want to go stay in school. So they must be getting something out of it. They must be enjoying it.
Good afternoon. We'll present the certificates in just a moment to our students, but I want to take a moment to introduce our teachers. They've done a fantastic job this year, and we appreciate your dedication. We have Marie Antoinette Adamasia. Marie Antoinette was a standout. She taught our pre-K through fourth grade, second grade students. Will Gray, standing in the back there. Thank you, Will. Thank you so much. So we'll go ahead and present the certificates. Okay, first is Ioannis Xenophontos. Christos Xenophontos. Cheyenne Cole. Isabel Cole. Samantha Abigazelli. Jessica Abigazelli. John Stevens. Hunter Gray. Rebecca Moore. Teresa Moore. Jacob Abdelmasia. Isaac Abdelmasia. Kevin Gautsatsi. Jason Gautsatsi. Tatiana Van Meter. Flanagan Nikolai.
Going down, please know that the wall will be locked.
some of you that I'm having, out of the devotion of Christ, I'd like to touch the top of the chalice and the great entrance. Please don't do this, because if you knock over the chalice, and that would be a disaster. So please, tomorrow, you know, make this order, but please do not touch the chalice. I want to welcome my brother, Father Juan Carlos Rios, who is visiting with us today. And also, I'd like to welcome my cousin, Victor Seyur. You know, I think of Victor often, almost every day, because I go in the backyard of my house and I pick grapevine leaves. Because he gave me a grapevine and I love those leaves. So if you like grapevine leaves, try and get friendly with Victor because he's got, he has a great plan. We will be in Pensacola this coming Wednesday through the Saturday, the 18th. God will be back here next Sunday, but we're going to the Barge Life Conference. Therefore, there will be no Bible service Wednesday and no Friday Divine Liturgy. In making this body harder. Also, please remember that if you're not going to be giving your membership offering, please do so as soon as possible. Please stand. Also, I'd like to welcome kids here, which is on the Robert. First time we're seeing what we're going to be. It's usually much cooler than this. Especially in January. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and the Lord, we express your thank you. Bless your praise and worship. We ask you much to protect us. Bless all the Lord, also, thank you to those who have heard of failures and tried each day, and bring into full knowledge of your love and grace. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. There's two lines. For the distribution of the bread, all the bread.